Tito, yes. Yes. And him saying, this top turns upside down when the revs drop to a certain level. And he says, the reason for that is impossible to explain in words, but I can express it mathematically very easily.
Yes.
But you can't explain it in words. Now, I think the mathematicians do maybe have a problem there,
yeah,
but they ought to try, there's no question. I remember, and probably you remember too, we were always told when writing up experiments to use the passive voice.
Oh, my God,
verb.
Yes. Mm.
That was, you know, that's journals
so
always had that.
So
you know, four rats were taken.
Yes,
and,
it was decided.
It was decided
yes,
that, and
yes,
so on. Without using the, yes, the first person.
I'm not terribly proud of my spell as editor of Animal Behaviour, but I did. That was one thing that I tried to abolish. The other thing was introduction, methods, results, discussion.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that pattern would sometimes follow through even when you had, shall we say, a series of four sets of experiments, where set one raised a question which led into set two, which led into three, which led into four. And naturally, the way to do that is to begin with one and then say, this raises a further question, let's go on. Instead of which, people would write papers that would have methods one, methods two, methods three, methods four. Results one, results two, results three, results four. That is literally what they would do, having been dragooned into this pattern of doing things. Nico, by the way, would never do that. I mean, the absolute model which I used to send to authors was the eggshell removal paper in Black-Headed Gulls, where each problem was solved and led into the next one, which led into the next one, and so on.
I completely agree. What a straitjacket a lot of young scientists were given. I think I was helped. Well, first of all, I had, like you, had Nico there, but also the first scientist I really had to read seriously in my subject was Darwin.
Yeah.
And I happen to be, it's okay, I love Victorian writers, Victorian novelists, and his prolix style I found immediately attractive. And of course he does just as you say,
yeah,
that he gives a narrative of how his ideas evolve.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who was it as said, I think, that the many scientific papers are a complete falsification of the truth?
Peter Medawar.
Yes, Peter Medawar.
Yeah.
That's right. Because they do go things, they don't go in the way in which your mind works.
Yes, yes.
And everybody knows you write the introduction, the last thing you write. Yes, how do you know what you're going to introduce until you've done it?
Yes.
So it is phony. And I like to think that's breaking down now. I think it is. And of course, you're the best person to say this to. The standard of popular scientific writing is enormously improved now. I mean, the last 10, 20 years, I think, have seen some wonderful, accessible science writing.
That's true, and also textbooks have improved.
Yes.
When you think back to, did you have Grove and Newell when you were...
Yes, yes. Oh, I loved Grove and Newell.
Well, you didn't really.
No.
You didn't. something about teaching science, teaching biology, as though it was a branch of Latin grammar was really what it was about to.
Yes.
Old sort of schoolmasters... covered with chalk, this is how I imagine them. Nowadays we've got these wonderful textbooks with coloured pictures and blue boxes and things.
Extraordinary.
Yeah.
J.Z. Young, that's right, Grove and Newell, Parker and Haswell, Beps Borrowdale, Easton, Potts and Saunders. Mm. And then J.Z. Young's Life of the Vertebrates came on. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Was a breath of fresh air.
Absolutely, yeah.
And then The Life of Mammals and so on, in which it described the whole life, you know, the animal's a living creature, really, whereas Grover Newell really, you know, was. Nonetheless, I can see Grover Newell's dissection of the earthworm, which I learned at school, and I loved it. I did. I so had such a thirst for biology at that
time. Yes, but even Grover Newell didn't put you off, is what
even
you know,
Grover
must.
Newell
yes.
didn't put me off, no,
yeah.
completely. But I think it's extremely important, and what you and a number of other authors have done is to produce wonderfully accessible modern science at the cutting edge, and also made it very challenging too. I mean, your books have been challenging, of course they have, because it's the clarity, the use of good metaphors. I think it's been wonderful. And I struggle, whether you do this, but I do try about every 6 months. I try to read a popular book on cosmology. There are many of them now. At the moment, I'm going through Lee Smolin. He's a very interesting guy, and this is called The Trouble with Physics.
Yes.
It's all about, he's against string theory and so on. And I do struggle with this. I mean, it's good, but nonetheless, these guys are giving us an insight into how physicists are thinking. So returning to our earlier point, I think this is particle physicists introducing us to particle physics as a human endeavour.
Yes. You know?
It's very, very important, I think. I think we want to see science as part of culture.
Precisely, yes.
Anyway, you... have been at the forefront of introducing evolutionary ideas to the public. And, you haven't been backward in leading with your chin in a number of cases. So I don't doubt that you have... your inbox must be fairly interesting at times.
Well, yes, it's all right. I mean, I think there's a certain tendency for people to react to this leading with the chin. I don't really lead with my chin, but people think I do, and so it I do get a sort of hostile reaction to what people think I say, whether I do or not. Your television programs, like the one on geology, for example, presumably that you didn't receive much hostile response to that, or did you get any response from creationists about that?
No, I didn't. Well, I did get response. I got a fair number of tracts coming through the mail, and once or twice some letters talking about, you know, there are no intermediate fossils and all this sort of stuff. But you raise a very interesting point there, because I've been struck by, if you go to James Hutton and his theory of the Earth, 1785, and there he, his famous... you know, summing up at the end, we see no vestige of a beginning, no prospect of an end. I would have expected that, coming when it did, to have roused a huge furore. It did arouse some criticism from divines, and I suppose from probably people in other branches of science, as it then was. But, of course, not a tiny fraction of the furore that Darwin caused. And I remember you, in one of your essays, writing that you found it puzzling that some aspects of truth, such as, for instance, the physical laws of the universe, are accepted completely.
Yes.
Nobody questions the four great forces and so on and so forth. Well, and you found it puzzling that Darwin's, which is all equally is just a truth, why it causes such problems. But I think I know why that is, and I'm sure you understand this. Knowing about the structure of the atom and quarks and leptons and so on and so forth doesn't, I mean, it's remarkable, but it doesn't really change the way we feel about ourselves.
Yes.
Whereas Darwin, of course, did. And for many people, it still remains a very challenging thought that we are just one end product of a process of natural selection. I don't know about you, but my feelings are I don't think this will ever go away, actually. I suspect every, no matter how much people like yourself try to explain and gradually how the aspects of evolutionary theory get more and more filled up, I don't think it'll ever go away, that.
There are various aspects of it, aren't there? I mean, in Victorian times, part of it was a reluctance to accept cousinship with chimpanzees and monkeys. Nobody's going to tell me I'm descended from a monkey. And that's a sort of feeling that monkeys are sort of, I don't know, dirty and comical and so on. That was part of it. But I think more profoundly, it's providing, what Darwin did was to provide an explanation which is ultimately mechanistic for those things which we had thought we had, like a soul and eternal life, something that would go on after our death, something that made us peculiarly human. There are all sorts of ways in which Darwin cuts away at human pretension.